I'll just say officially.
So good morning, dear colleagues. We start our final day. And the third session is called Contemporary Communicative Stimuli for the Emergence of National Music. And our first chairman is Miloš Zatkalik from the University of Arts in Belgrade. Welcome, Miloš. Chair is yours.
Is it? Yeah, okay. So once again, hello everyone. Thank you for your perseverance. Let's say we can start with Charis, Efthimiou. Have I pronounced it correct? Very good. Miške versus in the forest. I believe Miške also means in Lithuanian in the forest. Yeah, yes, yeah. I learned that much. Okay, please.
University studies that there are two ways at least of presenting to conferences. One is you say what you want to say, you make a summary, and then you start and then you finish with a summary. And the second is to start not telling to the people everything and try to create a story. So for the first time, I will try this, the second version. As you see here, you see a wonderful forest in the middle, left the composer Julianis, and at the right side, me. So we are now at the year 2015, this room, and I presented the features of the melody line of Julianis' symphonic poem Miške, which means in the forest. This piece has the is something like, you know, the national orchestra piece of this country. It's like Sibelius Finlandia from Finland. And I was very impressed to see. For example, here is a summary of some of the results of 2015, that actually this boy, that was his first orchestral symphonic effort, this boy succeeded to Leonis to create a symphonic work where almost all the reoccurring melodies have a different instrumentation. Without any repetitions. So when you hear this famous melody, Sol, Re, Do, Mi, almost always comes with a different timbre. So my respect for this composer has raised significantly. Now I would just want to show you the score, the first edition of 1985. And it will be, yeah. As you see, 1975, at bar 28, we see this poco animato, which means we have a higher tempo. And as you see here, poco animato. This is now the score of 2000. I want to remove this. I don't know where to put, okay, here maybe. Yeah, so as you see, it says mosso poco animato. My specialization, one of my specialties is the editing of manuscripts of 18th and 19th century in a critical way. And in when you read this, it means the composer wrote mosso, 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 animato, and then somehow once he forgot this poco animato, so we need to add it, and we're sure that he wanted to write this, but he wanted to save ink. It was too expensive, maybe. So now let's check the manuscript. So the manuscript, as you see, says mosso, and this mosso is not from the hand of the composer. Here there are several experts in the field of Julianis that they are assured that this is not the handwriting of the composer. And also Vytautas Landsbergis also said that he never writes mosso, he writes menomosso or piumosso. So here I understood that there are serious issues considering the authenticity of this work. And so I went to the museum myself to check everything. So I am the only foreigner that holds the national heritage of this country in my own hands. Yeah, I was very happy about this. So I have a good contact to the ladies at the Museum of Kaunas, of Čiurlionis in Kaunas, which they have all paintings of the composer and almost all manuscripts. So then I went to Rokas Zubovas for a coffee. Rokas is the grandson of the composer, a very profiling pianist of the music of Čiurlionis, and has a deep knowledge of the manuscript. So I told him those things that you can read here, that we have two scores, and these two scores, they didn't contribute to the authenticity. So we need to do something. Okay, the pandemic started and nothing. And after 7 months, Rokas phones me and say, Charis, do you know, I got a funding for you. We can start with the complete works of the composer. So we had a group of scientists with, as I heard, it was the rector of the university. Grażyna Donoravičienė is one of the biggest musicologists at the moment in Lithuania. Darius Kucinskas is the person that knows the manuscript most of all of us. And that's me at the end, as you see, Charis Efthimiou. So we started, and you see here, it's everything in Lithuania, not in English, with the volumes, how the volumes of this complete works will be. And of course, we need now a new numbering that correlates exactly to the volumes. This is how they have done with Bach, with Fuchs now, or with Eisler, and so on. So here comes that since 2015 that I gave this, I attended this conference until now, my first postdoc was on the complete works of Pleyel. So I was responsible for the symphonies. So I learned a lot from my mentors in terms of authenticity and manuscripts. So then we had an opportunity. The opportunity was from Peter Mathisens from Belgium, and he gave us the opportunity. He said, okay, if you edit Miške is the in the forest, yeah, to edit it in the original way, there are many issues that we need to check. Do they really function? Different articulation, the articulation of the composer, and different tempi, the tempi of the composer, can it function? So he gave us this opportunity. And that was excellent. And the premiere was end of April this year in Belgium, in Antwerp. So I went to Peter in one of our Zoom meetings and I said, Peter, just a question. Do you have 5 minutes free during this concert? I said, yes. So I would like to compose a piece. I'm a composer, which is based on Miške. And there are a lot of connection points between In the Forest, my piece, and Miške. I said, yes, we can do that. And during this concert, the world premiere of my piece was at the beginning and the world premiere of the manuscript version of Čiurlionis. Of course, this was an orchestra of amateurs. And he asked me, can you compose for amateurs? I said, yes, I have written a cello concerto for a soloist from Klangforum Vienna, but the orchestra were amateurs. I have an experience of what to do. So now we come back and now you can understand of the right side, In the Forest, my orchestra piece, and left, Miške. Here we see the parameters. I need to take this here. See, you see the parameters here that really communicate the instrumentation. I use the whole orchestra, the same orchestra. I use the harp. The harp comes once at this piece. So I used also this feature to my orchestra piece. The strings were not until now the main corpus of my orchestra pieces, but for this they became, because for Miške, there are. Harmonic, in terms of harmony, there is a specific harmonic progression during this Miške that it is very famous in Lithuania. So it has a specific harmonic rhythm, which I used for my piece. And there are specific motifs that come and leave and come and leave. And also very important, the gesture of the wind. Tuarim. That was the pine trees of this region that I have shown you before, with this magnificent forest, which I go every September and August to collect berries and mushrooms together with my Lithuanian family. And also some biographical aspects of the life of Tsiulionis that they have a correlation, a communication with my own family. So now I want to present you a little bit with some small 20 seconds of music examples. How do I think as a composer? I listen sounds, and I listen microtonal sounds. And these sounds have nothing to do with the spectral issues, neither nor with the overtones. And they don't have also, they have very few things to do with Giacinto Scelsi. It's just there where they are. And they compose with a specific way, which we can discuss if we want to afterwards during our coffee. So I would like to show you now to present you a couple of seconds of my second string quartet. And I hope now it will function. My personal aesthetic, my personal idea is, if you check the forest, because we speak about the forest, you see trees, but none, we understand that they're trees, but none of those trees are identical. In the same way functions my second solo piano piece, which has a clear gesture, as you see from up until down, but some other parameters are a little different. The length, as you see, the dynamics. We start identical, but then we have different dynamics. But at the other side, there are some other parameters like pitch, for example, the first note, that is always the same. So in going to my next piece, I became a heavy metal researcher the last 10 years. And of course, there are some riffs which I like very much. And those riffs, then I used them and modified them to my own musical pieces. For example, this one is a riff or a different version of Master Passion Greed of Nightwish. Now we will listen this riff from Nightwish and then the beginning of my piece. So this communication thing follows me the last 7-8 years at least. And of course, my orchestral piece that I will present you today is not the first piece that works, that has some kind of communications. Left side, the critically edited score of Tsiulionis' Miške. Right side, my piece in the forest. If we check Tsiulionis, I don't know what this thing is doing here. So there is some gesture going up and then going down. So this continues. So I took this gesture and you see modified here. Also, according to harmony, now just a small thing, how to compose for amateurs. It sounds impossible to have a microtonal piece for amateurs, but if you check here viola, it's one note of the first position and you start and you just start and you go down a quarter note. Every 15 years old viola player can play the first note correctly and just go a little bit lower. Cello, the same thing. You play G, as you see, is the third string, and then you just go from the upper string a little down. So you have it. So you have a microtonal chord here, which is the chord which I have heard. And then try to notate. So this is again the first page of Miške. And we have the strings and we have the horns. Okay. So this is my a part of my piece where the strings are playing this chord, and up we have the horns, but they're doing different things, as you see. And here comes into play my brother, my own family. Giulionis was an ill man. Giulionis was having most probably, we call it today, bipolar disorder. When he went 1909 to St. Petersburg, his best friend Morawski from Poland was telling him, please, Mikalojo, eat, please, we have letters, please drink, please sleep. And he was very poor and he had many ideas and he didn't have money. So of course he didn't have almost anything to eat. And of course he was so creative and he was working so much that he was not sleeping. And the same was with my brother that has the same disease in a severe stadium. And he was in Poland for 6 years. And of course, he's a global player, a manager, manages groups of architects that they manage other people that they do renderings. I don't understand what is he doing, but he's a global player of global player manager. And of course, he was not eating and not sleeping. So he went the first time to the clinic, like Giulionis. Giulionis stayed there and never came out. But my brother, thanks God, 21st century, got the medicament, stayed 2 months, slept, and then came out. Again, he was not doing what he needed to do. And then my brother again was starting not sleeping. And again, he went a second time. And the doctors and we said to him, if you do that again, you will never come out. So he came to Greece, back to my parents, and now it's everything fine with him. So it was nice to, not nice, it was interesting to see all those symptoms of the disease since 20 years. The more he was dealing with esoteric and more dealing with metaphysic and such stuff, the more ill he was. The better he was, the easier he could work for his job. So I have personal experience how it is. And all doctors are assured that if you have this disease, the latest at the age of 18, which was the year, let's say, Giulionis composed it after he was 18, this disease already comes out. Symptoms you have already, but almost no one, even you yourself, you don't recognize. So why all those stuff are important? As you see, upper part Giulionis, lower part myself. Because we have progression of four chords, Giulionis. This now has to do with the horns of before. I will come back to that. So for each chord progression, I give one color. And here is Miške. Okay, as you see, first chord, 2 bars, 2, 2, 1. And then what Giulioni does, this is now the score from an overarching perspective, is that he, after the first appearance of the chord progression, he augments that. So we have 7 bars playing this chord, and then 5 bars, and then 5 bars, and then 3 bars. So this augmentation I used for my own piece. And then this is the beginning of my piece. And then we have the same chord progression, microtonal now, but as you see, I augmented far more. We have overlapping also chords. This is the third, and this is the fourth. Now comes into play that we go to the forest and we have this bipolar disorder like my brother, that all of a sudden he was having some kind of crazy ideas that came out of nothing. And let's say this is the final part of the last chord. And then comes this hit, yeah? And this derives harmonically from those chords of horns that I have shown you before. And then I go back to the previous chord, and then I go back again. And from that until the end of the piece, we have a back and forth. Now I don't know if I have enough time to play you this. Yeah, I think no. Yeah, yeah. So I think we started 10 past 5. I have another 5 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah. So this continues, as you see here, this kind of hits continue and continue. And now we have the end. And here comes a point that that is very important for my own piece, which I've learned from my professors like Beat Fura, Georg Friedrich Hasch, Pallinger, and Pierluigi Bilone, that it is, if you bring a material in the same way and you repeat it, this is almost like the death of the material. So there the piece finishes. So, okay, this pop, 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 finish, yeah? And then in this moment that the piece finishes, as you see here, it's obvious for me that it will finish, I bring this glissando, as you see there, that doesn't fit actually to the piece. And that has to do with a personal experience of mine that had that deals with Tsouliones. And it is, this is the part. These are paintings of Tsouliones, 1905. I need to take again this. So we are not now in 1920 or 1930 and no workshop of 2022. This is 1905. This is 1906, five. You can see what kind of painter he is. I'm showing you the, so to have an idea of those kinds of paintings. Incredible. And now we are in the clinic, and I can say that I am very honored to be one of the fewest people ever that had the opportunity to grab with his, with my hand, with a, their hands, the last painting of Tsouliones. Very few people have seen this painting, and very few people have touch this painting. I mean, one of the fewest. So a little bit, those are the previous paintings. And this is a painting a couple of months before he died. For the Lithuanians, this is a shock. Okay? And this inspired me to bring this glissando at the end. For the Lithuanians that know Tsouliones, we have the ships, symbol of sun, symbol of the sky, the birds are here, and we have also the cities, the lost cities or the cities far away. Everything is here. So there are two tendencies: to believe that he was crazy, so something crazy came, or it is the beginning of a new era, but unfortunately he died. Okay, so in only 20 minutes, there are a lot of other stories that deal with this communication between Miške and in the forest, but in a nutshell, and that was a short description of what happened between in the forest and Miške. Thank you so much for your attention. And now if after the discussion, I get 2 minutes, okay, we will discuss maybe 8 minutes. I need 2 minutes to present to the Lithuanian public the newest scientific research considering their masterpiece, Jura. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Very interesting for me, who has done neither manuscript editing, nor have ever tried to fashion my own work on somebody else's. So I just need to ask you, when you started working on your symphonic piece, have you had any preconceived plan? Now I have the totality of Giuliani's work, and now I'm going to see through by applying this and this and this procedure. Or you just let yourself go along with the music and intuitively altered Giuliani's ideas for your own purpose?
Yeah. How do I compose? Me personally, subjectively. I hear sounds, and then if it is possible, then it's like a CD that plays the next track so I can see how it goes. Then I don't like this as a stop. Then the next track and the next one until the 20th, which I find something that I like. And then I say, play it once more, once more, once more. Then I got it. Next CD, we have this track, play the next one. So it continues. So this is the way that I compose. According to this piece, was a challenge. Can I have this chord progression and listen something from the CD that is a microtonal version of this chord, of this chord progression? If no, sorry, no orchestra piece. If yes, then yes.
Okay. Question?
Karis, thank you for your presentation. I have a question about your compositional process. This engagement with intertextuality that you showed in your symphonic piece, is it your compositional approach or compositional technique, compositional strategy in general, or is specific to this piece? This is first part, and if we have time for the second part, in terms of communicating with the listener, composer can do so much, right? You cannot control listener, but what would be something that you really want your listener to get from the composer via performance?
First of all, the audience will never understand that we have this chord progression. Okay, if it had been a 40 minutes lecture, I would have played some parts. Yeah, but there is no on purpose. It's so composed that you will never get, you will never understand this chord progression. Zubovas, Rokas was at the concert and said, I don't understand. Where is this chord progression here? I don't get it. So on purpose like this. And the honest answer is, I heard this microtonal chord and I heard how it goes. So first part of the question, when I was dealing with the music, heavy metal music analysis that also presented here a couple of times, the situation was that I was just walking around or in the forest or at home or I don't know what, I heard the CD came by itself, and that was for piano, and that was with this actions notation, this motif, this riff that was transposed in this way. So I said, aha, very interesting. And then comes the dealing with music theory and musicology. And as the colleague yesterday said, you must have the experience of instrumentation, music analysis, music theory, and musical form, so as to know what to do with this, what you have. But it just came. When it comes, then I take it.
Hello, Charis, and
hello,
thanks. Thanks for your presentation, and thanks for your passion, getting deeper and deeper into Charis, and also this huge work making a critical edition of Miške, and that's really interesting. Will be when it will be published, as you already said, that it is planned to be next year. So it's really a great event that we are expecting. My little comment, maybe, as you mentioned and showed some cases of microtonal appearance in your composition, I remember 2 years ago, maybe we talked about, I made a presentation on microtonal music, and we were talking with you about this type of composing, that we may say that there are some composers that use microtones like additional sounds, and it may be a systematic composing.
Yes.
So in this case, what you showed, I would say, would you call it microtonal composing? Because I would say there was just addition of several sounds, of several pitches to regular, to traditional pitches.
I could say that it's not that we have C, F sharp, D, and A, and then we just have a quarter tone over it or under it. It's just this tone in between. This is not, this is in between, and this is not. So there is an equality of temperate and non-temperate tones. So if you have a let's say they call it in German Gerüst, if you have a main chord or a main sequence of chords that they are temperate, and then you just raise them a little bit up and down, then yes, in my case, the microtones are equal to non-microtonal tones. So in this way, I could say I belong to the, I don't know to which category I belong, but from the point of view that I use microtones, it's microtonal. I don't use, it's not spectral, a little bit Sudoku now. It's not spectral. It is not according to the overtones, like Georg Friedrich has a different system. And Giacinto Scelsi has another system. This is the note, and then you go up and down, up and down, up and down of this note. So it's also not this. So it is something else. So now I think I think we need to move on.
If we just give me two minutes. Okay, give me two minutes
because they are very important for Lithuania. According to the two protocols that Professor Landsbergis has presented, when the Second World War came and Lithuania was occupied by the Soviets and there was a Soviet Republic. For Miške, the piece that we know, was everything was all fine for the regime, but Jura, the original Jura, was so innovative that the party commissioned Balsys, or maybe the threatened Balsys, to rearrange it in a way that the instrumentation will not be two steps before Ligeti, like now it is the original, but clearly to look to Rimsky-Korsakov, Richard Wagner, maybe also Richard Strauss. So this is an evil regime, because if you say, I don't like this piece and I prohibit this piece, as soon as the country will become independent, they will say, okay, we want not to play this. It's our piece. But no, they learned, the Lithuanians in the school, that this was not good instrumentated. That was Balsys that made it in a better version. And finishing with that, I wouldn't have done anything, what am I doing, if I wouldn't have had Jadwiga Čiurlionytė, the sister, who was the first Lithuanian musicologist. Professor Landsbergis, also Kuczynskas, Darius Kuczynskas, and also Professor Janelauskas, which sits here. So these four people, they gave me the template, gave me the basis. Those are the giants to which I sit on them, so as to see further. Many thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We need to move on. So I invite Szymon Borys to deliver the paper Music as a Personal Communicate, Homage and Message in Works of György Kurtág.
So one moment and we will start. Yeah, this small presentation, it's okay.
Share screen.
Okay, so I'm very happy to be here and to have this chance to speak about Kurtág and his music. I must say that I'm a little bit stressed because Kurtág was yesterday topic on Mr. Lewandowski presentation. So I'm a little bit stressed because my approach to this music is a little bit different. And the second reason why I'm stressed is Professor Dina. I must say that when I was choosing my for the doctoral, your papers has the decisive influence on me. So it was really very important, and I'm really stressed about this, all these things which I try to tell you to all of you. So about speaking about Kurtág, I want to start with express some kind of paradox. I tell about this paradox as a Kurtág paradox. It means for me, it is about his way to communicate in music, because he is, which is often a quote about him, that he music for him is a strictly private affair. So it's obvious for composer, but he's very confident about this, that music is a strictly private affair for him. And in some interviews which he made, he tell something different, I think, about quick on questions about communication. He always say something different. Always said something different. For example, Balint András Varga asked him, "My impression, which I repeat every time we do an interview, that for you composition stems from a deep seated desire to communicate rather than from the wish to realize a particular musical idea." And answer, "This is difficult. How shall I put it? Very little of it's conscious in any way. I'm not aware of any intention to communicate. Nowadays, I do not seem to want anything. For some reason, I just do it. I must do it." In this way, he repeat his answer 3 times on this question about communicate. For example, the second answer on the question about kind of story which is used in one of the on his piece, he said, "In any case, I'm not aware of any conscious wish to want to communicate something." Very confident. "One thing is certain. Composing is it made me terribly happy, especially in the last section, the sketches of which I completed recently. There is still quite a lot of work to do on it." And also in the same interview for the third time, "It may have to do with my age, but basically I have not changed. I am not aware of any desire to communicate. In everyday life, I'm a boring person. Marta, wife of Mr. Kurtág, has a dual time with me." And it's quite hard to understand. And this is why of the reason why I sometimes don't believe for composers, because in his music, he so often use words like message, like homage. It's kind of main subject of his music, I think. So we have kind of paradox, and my presentation is I try to do something with this paradox. Just try. Maybe some good points we have. And second approach to his music is that I need to mention about it, that Kurtág is very interested in languages, all languages. He's native Hungarian, but he was born in Lugos, which is in Romania. He speaks very well in, of course, in Hungarian, Romanian, but also in German, French, Russian, English, and he's very famous for that, that he composed music, vocal instrumental music, but he need to learn language which he used. He don't set up music in language which he not learn. Yeah, so for Russian composition, he learned Russian. For German composition, he learned German. And it's quite, I think it's quite special for him. And of course, the topic of language is strictly linked to aspect of communication. So it's very important, I think. For the next topic in this and in this context, I want to show you one fragment of video when Mr. Kurtág and his wife Marta will play for 4 hands one of short piece from his games for 2 pianos, for 1 piano, sorry, 4 hands. They finished on the same note, yeah. So I think it's very, very good example. Music is an example for this aspect of communication in his music. Of course. Not this. Kurtág's music is often compared to Webern because of the very strict material, only three notes in this piece. Yeah. Next things in this subject is that for Kurtág, music is as language is the same because of the syntax. We can think about this in that way, I think. The next thing which inspired Kurtág to think in music as a language is that his first teacher, Felicien Binzu, gave him a good lessons on the Romanian grammar. And I want to tell something about this because it's very important, I think, for this topic. So Kurtág remembered of the classes of these lessons because of unusual teaching methodology, completely devoid of grades and focused on collective discussion of the material as part of a team word game. He was deeply impressed by the classes devoted to the case of the vocative. Through playing together, Binzu explained the rules governing the structure of the language. This experience played an important role in the formation of Kurtág's musical language, to the overreaching feature of which was the construction of limited sound cells following the pattern of syllables in the construction of words. So kind of music cells, very, very tiny, he take from the language, just from the Romanian and from also the Hungarian language. His music is very aphoristic, like kind of message, also in big forms, like opera, which takes two hours. So it's very, very, very important that he made this huge form from tiny, little forms. And of course, the subject of homage and or message. Time is okay. Now I want to say something about this why he composed music used so often these two words, message and homage. And I think the key for this is to understand the biography of Kurtág, especially the beginning of his way as a composer and as a human being. So, this is Kurtág as a child with his mother. And now I want to say about his relation with mother, because probably this is the most important thing in this topic. His mother was Blanka Weisberger. She was a Jewish woman who ran a local shop on a daily basis. In her spare time, she was keen on playing piano and was pianist also. It is thanks to his mother that Kurtág's interest in music became his fascination. The most significant childhood memories he has are connected with his mother. In those memories, he especially recalls dancing together during summer evenings and playing with her a piano duo on four hands in winter. It's quite important, piano duo, like with his wife. He play also piano duo very often. One of the memories he has is about playing with mother Beethoven's Third Symphony. He noted that she didn't want to perform a funeral march. She refused always to play this movement. Kurtág thinks that was because of some kind of superstition of premonition she had. And in fact, she died very, very young. And it was kind of trauma for Kurtág, because when she died, he was in Budapest, and he tells something like this about these memories. My father wrote me as much in a letter. Then I had been staying with my aunt's family in Budapest for 3 months, had not sent a single letter home in all that time. It pains me to this day. In his message, and I underline this word because I think it's very important, my father had also written that my mother had been unconscious for 2 days. The letter was delivered to me by repatriate Hungarian doctor. Shyly, I asked him if she would stay in that condition much longer. His brutal reply came as a shock. No, she died 2 weeks ago. That is how I learned of her death. So I think this memory, which is important, very important in all Kurtág's music, all Kurtág's output, has also the meaning in this way of message, because all of his music is kind of message, but the main question is message for whom, I think. We cannot understand it correctly, because it depends on a piece of music. But I want to show you this way to music written in this way, like message, on just one piece, because we don't have time. And this piece will be Ligatura, Message to Frances Marie. The subtitle of this piece is The Answered, Unanswered Question. I think it's also very important in this aspect of communication. So the piece has three versions. The first is very unusual because it's for violoncello with two bows. It's very unusual technique, but Frances Marie Witty played, and I think she made this technique. Also two violins and celesta. Second version, two violoncellos, two violins and celesta, and third version, organ, one organ, second organ, and celesta. So the same for this three version is celesta. And this is also important. And of course, I think it's obvious that this piece refers to Ives' unanswered question. And I want to introduce this in note to score written by Ives about this, about his piece. So Ives wrote, the strings are to represent the silence of druids who know, see, and hear nothing. The trumpet intones the perennial question of existence and states it in the same tone of voice each time. But the hunt for the invisible answer, undertaken by the flutes and other human beings, becomes gradually more active, faster, and louder through an animando to confuoco. And just 3 minutes, this piece, I think we have just 3 minutes. I want to listen this this short piece and look at this, how Kurtág wants to answer to this unanswered question. And answer to this question, this unanswered question, but Kurtág tries to do in his own way. But I think it's kind of game with these meanings. Of course, this question which gave to us Ives is existential. We cannot answer it in any way. But Kurtág tried to do, and I want to end my presentation with this slide and. Just give some question, not no answer, but question. If Kurtág is a sender of communicate, or message. So who is the receiver of this message? Also, it could be the performer. It could be Frances Marie in this case, but not only, because also he himself. Could be a receiver of this message, and probably this is the reason why he composed all these pieces. Because he, I think, maybe I'm wrong. Probably I'm wrong. maybe all his music has related to these memories, to his mother, and he tried to link with her or with these memories. I don't know, but I think it's very important and I'm very curious about this topic of message in his music, because I really don't understand why he uses it so often. So I'm very interested about your feelings about this subject. So thank you.
Well, I have sort of discreet look at a Kurtág expert here.
I don't want to be called an expert, but I am. You know, I love Kurtág's music.
As compared to
not necessarily, Thank you so much. Well, it was so good to hear your presentation, because like when I wrote my stuff, I was more in structuralist mode and I kind of disregarded Kurtág's feelings, because he doesn't trust musicologists. He didn't let me publish interview with him because he said, you don't understand me. And so maybe, and I started thinking about him through your presentation, actually, his personality, because I kind of thought that he is very, he's a warm person in the kind of very kind of standoffish
very
way.
Cold also, very cold person in some way.
Yes, and he has problems with communication. For instance, he insisted he speaks Russian to me, but he spoke so slowly. I'm like, would you like English, anything? He said, no, Russian. And it was hard to talk, actually. But first of all, maybe that's why his music is saturated with messages and homages. Maybe this is his way of communication, the only way that came easy for him. But also, what I just want to say about message to Frances Marie, because I also posed that question for myself when I was working with that piece. And because the silence of druids, he definitely incorporated that layer of Charles Ives' work, right? Yeah. In his piece. But the intervallic content of those harmonies include all other layers of Ives' piece, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I'm sure you analyze pitch class. So he does incorporate question into this and flutes, looking for answers. So he mixed up everything in that. So the Silence of Druids, they actually absorbed, I think, everything. Yeah. So to me, the answer is that there is no answer. At least that was my conclusion. What's yours?
The same, I think. Beautiful moment with this celesta. I think this is yesterday in Homage to Robert Schumann, this Grand Casa on the end. This is kind of last word of composer, and he's trying in this place to tell something, maybe. But I understand this structure approach, and I also in my doctoral thesis I do it very, very carefully. But today I just want to show you the roots of this music. I think the roots.
Right, but maybe Kurtág's message is like, look into my music. My answers are there.
Yeah,
I'm not going to talk to you. Listen to my music. And yes, so I think his communication is in his music. That's the only way that he relates to others, and that's why I think it's full of messages.
That's why he don't want to
talk
give
to anybody.
Interviews and
really dislikes all musicologists except for Andrius. Yeah, not Andrius. Andrius
Varga. Balint Andrius Varga.
No, I'll remember his name. The younger generation, his student, who is his confidant.
Yeah.
So there is one. Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay, Charis.
Yes. Just a small hilarious comment to this. Among us composers, there is a joke which says, what are 10,000 musicologists at the bottom of the sea? A very good start.
I must say that I've always been grateful to musicologists who discovered in my composition things I never dreamed of. Yeah. Means that they were doing their job. Okay, any other question, comment? I simply can't resist commenting on a few points that you made. You're questioning who is the receiver, but we know the sender. I don't think that we really know either the sender or the receiver. To be consistent with what I was saying in my paper, it's oversimplified to look at this simply as a communication. I, a composer, have to communicate it to you, the audience. It's more like non-personal, pre-personal network of communication somehow enmeshed us in that process in which the communication channels are much more complicated. I use the Deleuzean term rhizome, where every point can be connected to every other point, and communication channel just proliferate between them.
So
I wouldn't talk about this strict, you know, orthodox model, sender, channel, receiver, code between them. It's much more complicated.
In some way, as Kurtág said, for some reasons, he must do it, and he do it. So.
And, oh, okay.
Because I think that we should look as a musicologist. I have a comment because I also... I'm interested in the theory of communication. So we can look at music from different levels. So there are different levels of communication. It is called pyramid. So at the bottom, we have something which is called intrapersonal communication. And at the top, we have mass communication. And there are different stadiums. That's why that I think that your question, your slide was good, because you didn't said that it is the sender, receiver. We can interpret it in different ways. So that's why I think we should look at music in the most, open way as possible. So that's my comments, actually.
Echo.
Some comments. We always think that communication is only verbal way. Music also part of communication, so way of communication. Because Kurtág says that everything I say,
in this piano piece, for hands, we all feel this intonation, various intonations. So,
and it is free. You have to feel, and after you can, by verbal way, explain your feeling. I think this is exactly one way of communication. Thank you.
Well, I think we are running out of time. I just need to abuse my position to add two things. It is not Kurtág paradox, it is music paradox. And the second very interesting thing, personally, I believe that Kafka Fragment is an enchanting piece, and it's his masterpiece. Special affinity between him and Kafka, as sort of as Deleuze calls Kafka, minority writer, very much affinity in that sense. But this is the question which we'll leave unanswered for the time being, and we move to our next presenter. Do we have our next presenter? I believe he should be online. Thank you. So, do we have?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, very good. I have a special pleasure to announce Nana Amowee Dawson. I'm truly sorry if I didn't pronounce your name correctly.
Okay.
We really very rarely see African scholars here, so we are really very anxious to hear. Again, a word that I'm not sure how to pronounce. Kwadehyewa. Sorry, that's the best I can do. An artistic delineation of musical recycling. Please take the floor.
All right. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Good morning, everyone. My name is Nana Amowee Dawson. I'm a Ghanaian, and I'm so much happy to be part of this conference. This morning, I want to present my composition, which I titled Kwadehyewa. An artistic delineation of musical recycling. So for my presentation, this is going to be my outline. First of all, I'll talk about me as an artist, and then my artistic journey. And then I'll give a background to the composition. And then I will play the song, I will play the music for you, and then conclude the presentation. So I am an intercultural researcher and African music enthusiast. So whenever and wherever I get the opportunity, I try to, first of all, project African music. At the same time, find a space to expose my creations. I love to tell stories a lot with my music. In doing so, I convey messages and communicate African ideologies and musical expression. So today, I'm going to present to you one of my works. Kwadehyewa is a slice of a bigger work with different paradigms of analysis on the African traditional religion, African classicism, and dance macabre. It is an artistic reduction of the first movement of my master's thesis, Assamanasau. So Assamanasau was created on the concept of ancestral veneration to create a homecoming of the ancestors to dance, remember, and share what is on the other side after death. So how did I create this work? So between 2013 and 15, I enrolled in the University of Cape Coast's Master of Philosophy program in music theory and composition. During the course, I was introduced for the first time to 20th century compositional styles. I got an opportunity to be exposed to music concrete, atonal music, new complexity, minimalism, serialism, and so on. And as part of the course, we were required to compose a piece to reflect any of those trends. I needed inspiration to create, since that kind of music was new. And I have always sought to find that kind of balance, marrying traditional music with scholarly music. So bringing my experiences to the program as an Akan. I'm a Ghanaian, and my background, I'm Akan. It's an ethnic group in Ghana. And then using creative ethnomusicology as my mode of inquiry. And then again, being guided by Nketiah's African pianism theory, and again, Uber's theory of interculturalism, I set out to create an African classic to depict the African ancestors coming out of their tombs to dance. So I went to the field and collected a couple of indigenous tunes from an ensemble called Asafo, and then took them back to my studio, did a bit of musical restructuring and tweaking, and used the tunes as theme for the composition. So later I expanded the themes and added a bit of 20th century musical resources, especially harmonic resources. So I use power chords, polychords, duodecads, advanced harmony to compose a two-movement instrumental work called Asamana, so, of which I restructured for this particular music. So one of the tunes I use as theme is Kwadehyewa. Kwadehyewa is actually a tune, and it is a chant which is normally used to ignite patriotism among the local militia when they're going to war. Asafo is a Ghanaian Akan militia, and their music is also known as Asafo. Asafo music is very sophisticated, multi-layered and structured and textured, and mostly characterized with metrical and rhythmic modulations. So it is upon this texture I also fashioned my music. Now, this music I want to present, it was engineered towards a performance necessitated by a Kopeko program requested by the singer. So one of the performers, she got a scholarship to go and read masters in Europe. And then she reached out to me to compose something for her. And then the request was informed by an interest in 20th century compositional styles and techniques with a keen link to throwback, that is Sankofa, a cultural return to roots in the hopes of creating art forms to tell African stories. When she reached out to me, I designed a concept of musical recycling. And again, purposeful leadership was a topic that I really wanted to write about. And so I used these two pillars and restructured the first movement of my work, and then created Kwadehyewa out of it. So this song, this music I'm about to play is a poetry of music in which I use musical elements metaphorically to admonish African leaders to do their best to lessen the plights of their people or face the consequences of their neglect when karma strikes. So let's listen to the music now.
Can you share sound?
We cannot hear you. You should share the sound.
Okay. Sorry.
It's okay. Yeah, you should go to Zoom.
Okay. I went to the music. The video, okay, share sound, all right. Sorry for that. I thought you begin the music. Yes, can you hear now?
Yeah, it's good.
Okay. Okay, so that was the recycling I did. So let me speak a bit about the music. The music depicts the same ancestors coming out and then warning that leaders should try and then use the resources to better for the betterment of the people. If not, when karma strikes, it wouldn't be too good for them. That was when she stopped singing and then she was actually speaking, expressing that kind of message in the music. So it is always possible that this piece of music will become a victim of obsolescence over time. That is the law of nature. However, as death is inevitable in life, so is the message of this composition. It may seem a bit of a hubristic desire to yearn for more creations reflecting cultures in life. If not far-fetched, it could be a sine qua non for all artistic approaches to have a realistic backing as the world gradually metamorphoses into phases of hyper-reality. The fabric of ethnic authenticity and culture through the lens of contemporary perspective seems to wane by the second because a new world is evolving with conflicting identities that shell tradition's origin. Hopefully, this work would remind all that the frontiers of customs are still open and with more attention could release the shuttled ones to come back. After all, nothing ever is which ever existed. The we of today were the day of yesterday and with luck, the us of tomorrow. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. We'd certainly like to hear more of this music.
Okay.
Please. Comments, questions.
Thank you for presentation. I wonder, listening to this composition, we would say that it's very familiar, like traditional European music or like with the classical in classical style, but in one slide you mentioned that it was some kind of desire to get back to the roots or something like that. So may you explain what in this composition was would say specific for getting back to the roots but not this already familiar things which we heard. Thank you.
Okay, I think the theories I used, it was theory of interculturalism. And that theory, you just blend materials. The time I was creating this song, I was actually in school studying composition. And you know, there you were a bit limited in resources that you could only create for the piano, for the orchestra, you write for the orchestra and so on. So, the theme, the rhythms I used, all of them were from African origin. Just that the medium that I used to actually present this work is as it were using Western instruments and so on. So that is a blend that I spoke about. Trying to Asafo is very the way I got this music from. It's really complicated, but as it were. We are trying to create new forms, and again, I would wish that maybe one day I can present this work with the right texture and the right instrument and so on. So basically, the idea was to kind of blend traditional material with scholarly works and so on. So the theme, rhythmic interplay, everything over there, the use of the ululation, everything over there was African sourced. That is what I was trying to communicate. And again, now Africa is really a multi structured society. We have our music, but we can also have music of European origin, and we can now speak of them also as our music. For instance, we have now hymns being structured in our kind of musical structures with language and so on. So basically, it's African music, as it were, yeah.
Dina?
Yes. Thank you for your presentation and your music. My question has to do with your agenda. As a composer, you have a clear political and ideological agenda. So how do you and other composers of your generation make sure that your message is being heard by the addressee?
I think this is one of the first works that I have done to actually criticize leadership. You know, in our spaces, there isn't such works in the system. And so I really want to wean away from that kind of construct where the only music that you can churn out is gospel music and so on. So it would be difficult to try to push this thing. And it's not really political. I'm a musician and I can write about anything at all. So first of all, I intend to publish some of these works. Getting the sources to publish them is difficult here. So I intend to upload some of these works and then do more of them and then put them on YouTube and some of these streaming platforms. And again, premiere them for people to get the message of the things I want to do. So it is a niche I want to carve for myself as a composer. So throughout my schooling, I'm trying to deconstruct myself from the things that I've been taught so far. And now I want to use me and then my background to actually fight the system, try to write about things and so on, so that maybe there might be some kind of change. If I can get musicians like me to be doing what I'm doing, then maybe there'll be a headway. So that's what I seek to do with my music.
Hi, Nana. First of all, thank you for your presentation. We are really excited to have you here. It was like really a long time coming that we. You are the first African presenter ever here. Feel free to correct me if I'm wrong. I'm really excited about that, and I wanted to share some of my impressions about your piece. I don't know how familiar are you with the Western musical scene, but we also tend to do a lot of cultural references in our classical pieces, but we do it in a totally different way mainly. If that was a piece of a Western composer, authentic material would be kind of presented in a very quasi-authentic way. We would try to imitate the like national African sing or Lithuanian singing or use some kind of ethnic instruments. And what blew my mind is how the singer was singing in a very Western classical manner. And yes, it was really fascinating to see that kind of implementation with all the African materials presented in a very Western way. Yeah, it was totally opposite from what we do. So I was really impressed.
Yeah, it was really intentional. You know, to try to change something, it takes a bit of a time. Right now, it is so difficult for Africans, especially scholar musicians, to kind of sing their own songs. Because as I said, the education system is structured on the Western system. So from your lower levels to university, you are exposed to this kind of music. So what I try to do in my work is, okay, let me still try and stay in that paradigm, but again, gradually be chipping in the Africanness. Maybe as time goes on, I will try and take all those things out, and not entirely, because we have a whole large audience who are into Western music a lot. So presenting African music to them straight away, it wouldn't be too palatable. So that blend is where I begin from. As I go on, maybe things will be changing. Yeah. Thank you for the comment. Well,
thank you.
I'd like to take this point about the origin of certain folklore patterns. An ethnomusicologist, Kalliopi, assured me that even an experienced trained ethnomusicologist can actually miss the whole continent to attribute music from one continent to another if they don't really know the origin. So there are certain some uncanny resemblances. You know, we discovered some really fascinating almost identity between Serbian ritual song and ritual song in Central Flores in Indonesia without any possible cultural context between them. So there are some things that probably music goes to some deeper layers of human psyche, which are universal or nearly universal. Well, that's all fascinating. I'm really sorry that we need to move on to the next presenter. We hope we'll be in touch with Nana and hear more of his music in the future and his creative ideas in Africa, because you know there was time, and I'm afraid the time still is, that we somehow look for African tradition more like a museum exhibit than as a living creative field. So just we're thrilled to see these developments in you. Thank you very much. And
thank you so much.
And now we go to the last presenter in this session, which is again, I believe, an online presentation, since I don't see Kalliopi anywhere here. But we can see. Do we see her?
Hello.
What? Oh, okay. Very good.
Good morning.
Morning. So, you notice I don't introduce anyone. Just the name. You can read about biographies in the booklet. So the Mikis Theodorakis phenomenon, from the music score to the after concert, a unique channel of communication. Kalliopi.
Thank you. I will share my screen. I recorded the presentation. Can you hear? Good morning, everyone. Before starting my presentation, I would like to thank the scientific committee for the acceptance once more of my proposal. It was September 2nd, 2021, when the most famous Greek. Can you listen?
Yes, everything is fine.
Okay, thank you. In the whole world, Mikis Theodorakis died at the age of 96. The whole world bowed before the remains of the inspired composer, the communist fighter, the daring politician, the humanist academician. The union of peoples that he advocated throughout his life, through his original musical work, as well as through his relevant writings and speeches, is realized at this last moment. But how did a simple person manage to do this? Was he not one of us? Was he special? Was he a man phenomenon? According to the useful dictionary of the modern Greek language of the Academy of Athens, a human phenomenon is defined one who impresses, stands out, or surprises. Likewise, according to the dictionary of the new Greek language of the distinguished Greek linguist Georgios Babinotis, a human phenomenon is defined one who deviates by presenting a quality to an exceptional degree. The Dictionary of the Common Modern Greek Language, as it is posted on the portal for the Greek language, referring to the same definition, completes it by defining the word property with the words intelligence, temperance, honesty, skill. Thus, it is explained how he succeeded. The characterization of Mikis Theodorakis as a phenomenon is absolutely justified. Who could doubt his intelligence, temperance, honesty, or skill? The aim of this presentation is to shed the light on the process of creating the unique channel of communication that he built between his work, himself, and the audience all over the world, to propose ways of maintaining it in the post-Theodorakian era and to suggest new alternatives for disseminating the Theodorakian work in order for it to be preserved as a landmark of our cultural heritage. He was only 12 years old in 1937 when Mikis Theodorakis combined for the very first time the poetic language with the musical one, creating his first song, The Small Boat, in verses written by a known poet. Since then, and for more than 80 years, the logos, poetry, the melos, music, and the fight for freedom will define his life. Guided by his theory of universal harmony, which he established in 1943 at the age of 18, in the midst of the Second World War and while trying to reconcile the principles of Christianism with those of Marxism, he shaped his political activity on the one hand, that is the utopia of society wanting to partake of the gift of art, and on the other hand, his vision for the creation of a classless music, of the music for the masses. As he believed that art means freedom, and that is why it is addressed to free people, and that if the artist who is aware of the nature of his work wants this work to have correct and complete recipients, he should contribute to their release, being free, because only in this way his effort is completed, the achievement of his vision was identified with his struggle for freedom. Thus, in the early 60s, he led the Renaissance cultural and political movement of the fighting culture, which aimed at the democratization of social life and the deep renaissance of the Greek people through the creation of a classless music, of the music for the masses. Considering that the music for the masses, which was born from the marriage of the modern Greek popular music with the modern Greek poetry, had above all an educational and at the same time a liberating role, he used the concept of musical form to initiate every listener to the high art of music previously reserved only for an elite. He started with the simplest form, which is the song, namely the art song, to reach the opera, passing through new musical forms that were created at the time, such as the cycle of songs, the popular oratorio, the contemporary popular musical tragedy or popular opera, the flow song. The fusion of modern Greek and foreign poetry, which has always been his main source of inspiration, with melos, the melody that is deeply influenced by Byzantine music, Greek demotic and popular music, as well as Western European music, resulted in the creation of a united sound musical lyrical stochastic universe, consisting of more than 1,000 songs, of music for films, music for ballet, music for ancient and modern theater, of choral works, of a popular oratorio, a popular opera, flow songs, chamber music works, symphonies, operas, and of a requiem. It constitutes the musical galaxy of Mikis Theodorakis. In our paper, Rhythm and Greekness in the Cities of Mikis Theodorakis, presented on the frame of the 13th International Music Theory Conference, Principles of Music Composing Phenomenon of Rhythm in 2013, and in our paper, The Theodorakian Epic Lyric Melody, an Original Melodic Phenomenon, presented on the frame of the 15th International Music Theory Conference, Principles of Music Composing Phenomenon of Melody in 2015, we referred thoroughly to the two basic structural elements of Theodorakis' works, the rhythm and the melody. These two elements constitute the basis of a channel of communication formed between the composer and the audience. Thus, from the cycle of songs epitaph to the popular opera, The Ballad of the Dead Brother, from the popular oratorio Actionisti to the cycle of songs Rognosini, from the metasymphonic work The March of the Spirit to Canto General, From the film music Zorbazi Greek to the opera Lysistrata, the ensemble of Theodorakian musical galaxy, which is an expression of the high humanitarian ideals of peace, social justice, freedom, union of peoples, easily touches a huge audience, immediately becomes its property and passes into the collective memory. However, for the transmission of this precious message all over the world, the contribution of the composer through his writings mainly, but also his physical presence, as well as of the interpreters of this various and rich work, was and is necessary. Studying the scores of the works by Mikis Theodorakis, the performer finds, as always, notes and indications related to the way of interpretation. However, recorded rehearsals before a concert or in the studio, with Theodorakis on the podium giving instructions to the performers, and mainly the short notes, musical analysis of the work that the composer himself cites in his various literary texts, books, notes on the CD's booklet, concert programs, etc., are also important. His notes about the place, the period, the conditions in which he composed each work, as well as the socio-political context that inspired him each time, are important elements for capturing the style of each work by the performer. As an example, we mention, firstly, his musical analysis included, among others, in his two-volume book, The Debt, and more specifically, the one that refers to the style in which the third part of Actionist should be performed. I quote, "In the third part of the work, the Tsamikos dance dominates. A series of instruments, percussion, piano, santuri, etc., build from measure to measure this characteristic modern Greek dance rhythm. And on this rhythmic harmonic orchestral foundation, the choir develops the purely neo-Byzantine melody for two voices, primo secondo, according to the standards of the epitaph lament of Holy Friday. Here, however, both the structure of the melody itself and the set of rhythms, as well as its tempo, give it the necessary glorifying character," end of quote. And secondly, the composer's notes that preface almost every work in his three-volume book Poetry Set to Music, such as the composer's explanatory notes on Symphony No. 2, The Song of the Earth, in the second volume of this book. I quote, "I consider," he writes, "the second symphony as a sonic mural divided into four parts, four paintings, where the one emerges from the other, and all of them have common points of reference. For the listener to whom the work is addressed, what matters is the aesthetic emotional effect. I think that the lyrics of the Song of the Earth convey the general psychological and emotional, as well as the ideological climate that prevailed in my consciousness and thought at the time of composition. The message seems pessimistic, but within the whole economy of the work, it functions as a cry of despair, perhaps to scare, to enlist even 5 minutes before the house that international developments have now made clearly visible," end of quote. However, the contribution of the interpreter himself to the performance of each work is decisive, as he is the one who will activate the channel of communication that connects the composer and his work with the audience. Important performers of Theodorakis songs, with whom we spoke on the frame of our research into Theodorakis' work, refer to the way in which the composer himself inspired them and influenced their performance. As an example, we mention the testimony of the singer Manolis Mitsias, who referred to the composer's intervention both during a concert and during the recording of the cycle of songs CTC. I quote, "Mikis undoubtedly intervenes in the performance, not only when we are in the studio, but also during a concert. Last night, I was watching a concert we gave in 1994 in Thessaloniki with Actionist, and I remembered that Mikis was singing with me while conducting the orchestra. He was always singing on stage, and I remember that in the second verse of the song I opened my mouth, he was always asking me, 'What?' And I was giving the answer that exists in the next verse with more inner strength, with more emphasis and intensity. Mikis always intervenes, and fortunately he does. If he didn't, things would be quite different. I always wanted his intervention, and when we worked on CTC, I remember that he always intervened when I sang, and that helped me to understand certain things better. There are other things that I have just become aware of after so many years. I have just realized what Mikis really wanted." His muse and constant collaborator, Maria Faradouri, confirmed during our interview that, I quote, Each performance is a mixture of what Mikis transmits to me, of what he wants, and of my own expression, end of quote. But the choice of the performance by the composer was mainly a matter of intuition. Our question, based on which criteria does he choose the performer of a work each time, was answered by Theodorakis himself during our interview in June 2002. I quote, "The naturally popular element of the voice and in general of the interpretation of each artist is of a mysterious and therefore indefinable nature. It is not by reflection, but by intuition that I always choose my collaborators. I can't describe them, but there are some performers who shake me up and others who leave me indifferent. I cannot describe what upsets me, but there is something that makes me understand it. The voice influences me, it touches me a lot, and I understand that the person can absolutely be related to my music. Of course, I can be wrong sometimes, but that's what I'm looking for. I'm trying to understand if the person has a beautiful voice, a soft voice that is outside and far from his sentimental world, or if his voice expresses his deepest emotions," end of quote. Equally important in the successful transmission of Theodorakis' musical work to the audience was the choice of the concert venue. Considering that concert halls were usually intended for the presentation of works of classical repertoire destined to an initiated elitist audience, Theodorakis was the first to introduce in Greece in the 60s the model of the popular concert, which has had its roots in the concert demonstrations organized by the members of industrial workers of the world in the beginning of the 20th century in the United States, and which can take place in neighborhood squares, stadiums, or prestigious theaters. The goal is to be able to transmit the message conveyed by the music work to as many recipients as possible. Theodorakis biographer Yanis Flesas writes, I quote, "Thanks to the popular concert, I first wanted to break the barrier of the band, get closer to the people in the neighborhoods and in the provinces. But it wasn't just that. I believed that popular music should come out of trendy taverns and nightclubs. I also believed that the composer and the poet should come face to face with their audience. The abandoned, hunted people needed to feel their scholars near them, but we needed also the breath of the people," end of quote. A series of successful popular concerts were given by Theodorakis and his associates throughout Greece in the years before the dictatorship. During it, his music was banned and he was exiled or imprisoned for a long time, but his work was spread thanks to the large popular concerts organized by his collaborators abroad. After his release and his escape abroad, for almost 4 years, he toured the whole world and gave numerous concerts in which he internationalized the Greek problem. He denounced the junta and his concerts turned into protest concerts. The following description is typical, I quote, "During his exile abroad, Mikis Theodorakis gave thousands of concerts almost all over the world, concerts which were accompanied by interviews published in the press or diffused on the radio, by demonstrations, by speeches against the junta diffused on the TV. There were 20 concerts per month on average for 4 years. He made 3 tours in Italy, England, Germany, 4 in France. In Argentina, more than 20,000 people, and outside the venue, even as many, shouted Greece, Argentina, United will defeat the fascists. At the Caracas Stadium in Venezuela, 30,000 people cheered for democracy in Greece. With the fall of the regime and the return of Theodorakis to Greece, popular concerts continued and are a common practice to this day. At the same time, the ancient Odeon of Herodotus of Atticus, which was forbidden to him due to his leftist ideology, was granted to him only in 1988, where he performed Actionisti, conducting the orchestra himself. His physical presence as a conductor always strengthened the channel of communication with the audience. Unforgettable it is, his strong and proud bearing, the wide opening of his arms as if embracing the full orchestra and the whole world when he turned to the audience to encourage them to sing along with the performance. Having from my early childhood lived more than once the experience of both the popular concert and especially the protest courses in which Theodorakis was conducting the orchestra, as well as the popular concerts of the last decades in honor of the composer, I can confirm that orchestra performance and the audience were transformed thanks to the conducting or simply thanks to the physical presence of Theodorakis in a large choral. Oh, I'm sick of the carry. applause of the audience, the spontaneous, sometimes enthusiastic, and sometimes more lyrical singing of the audience at the same time as the performance, the excitement of the audience each time when, before the end of the concert, Theodorakis, with a nod, asked the orchestra to play one more song, one more melody, in order that the verses Πάνω στην άμμο την ξανθή γράψαμε το όνομά της. Ωραία που φύσηξε ο μπάτης και σβήστηκε η γραφή. Her name implied freedom. Or the verses, στρώσε το στρώμα σου για δυο, για σένα και για μένα. Να αγκαλιαστούμε από την αρχή, να είναι όλα αναστημένα. Over the well-known melody from Zorbas, where heard once more, will be etched forever in my memory and will always give me the same deep emotion. To this unique channel of communication, Maria Faradouiri says, I quote, This channel of communication is due to a reciprocal attraction between Mikis and the people, a strong relationship of love between him and the people, a mysterious and inexplicable relationship. In the case of Theodorakis, this relationship is explained by the truth of this his work. He was never cut off from the people. He never followed the model of an artist who creates far from the society. Theodorakis has always been a revolutionary, a fighter, a poet. He was always very close to the people, in the heart of the action where the events were taking place. End of quote. At the same time, it is obvious that no one can ignore the role of the numerous recordings nor the modern online ways of transmitting Theodorakian music in order to maintain this powerful channel of communication between the composer, his work, and the audience. Now, in the post-Theodorakian era, the protection of the ensemble of his work is, in our opinion, necessary so that it does not become a boon to bad interpreters and other supposedly inadequate scholars. The preservation of the unique channel of communication between the performers and the audience and the diligent and unimpeded dissemination of the Theodorakian work are equally necessary. New recordings, new interpretations, new research must see the light of day immediately, both in Greece and abroad. The music of Mikis Theodorakis should be the subject of study both at school and at university level. I address a proposal to your own academy: the organization of a series of lectures focusing on the music of Mikis Theodorakis in the frame of a course concerning the history of music of the 20th century, or of a course concerning the interdisciplinary teaching of music history and literature. The initiation of young children and young music students to the Theodorakian work can only contribute positively to the formation of their personality and possibly to the development of their musical talent. I am at your disposal for any cooperation. Furthermore, the establishment of music competitions in the frame of which the works of Mikis Theodorakis will be performed, and the award of prizes to the worthiest competitors in honor of Mikis Theodorakis, can be the trigger for further research, studies, and performances of Theodorakis' work. Finally, as a barrier of universal humanitarian ideas, which in our time alas are shaken every single moment, the music by Mikis Theodorakis must be spread, protected, and preserved as a precious stone in the edifice of the world's cultural heritage. Hence, we think that we could not conclude this presentation in a better way than the lyrics that Mikis Theodorakis himself wrote a decade ago in November 2012, when Greece was going perhaps through one of the most difficult moments in its modern history, weakened by the economic crisis and undermined internationally. Entitled The Sun, this short, always up-to-date poem summarizes the values of dignity, justice, union, democracy, for which Mikis Theodorakis fought tirelessly throughout his life with his political action and his musical creation, and which we must defend in perpetuity. Ο Ήλιος. Σε μια μικρή χώρα έγινε μεγάλο έγκλημα. Γι' αυτό κάθε νέος και κάθε νέα σε όλο τον κόσμο πρέπει να κλάψει πικρά. Γιατί όταν ποδοπατείτε ένα λουλούδι, είναι τα νιάτα του κόσμου που ποδοπατιούνται. Γιατί όπου σκοτώνεται ένα τραγούδι, είναι τα νιάτα του κόσμου που σκοτώνονται. Βοηθήστε, νέοι και νέες, να σηκώσουμε τον ήλιο πάνω από την Ελλάδα. Ο ήλιος μας είναι και ο δικός σας ήλιος. Είναι ο ήλιος όλου του κόσμου. Thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you, Kalliopi. Now, we know that Kalliopi has been specializing in Theodorakis for quite a while. We might have time for a few questions. We have their compatriot here. Perhaps he would want to make a comment or something.
Good morning, everyone. Before starting my presentation,
Sorry, excuse me.
What was that?
The video was restarted.
Oh, okay.
I have one question. Thank you very much for a very inspiring lecture and
we wanted to dance, actually, although we didn't understand the words because the music is so, you know, universal, I think. I would like to ask you about the reception, because you are interested in the sociology of music. And do you think after his death, can you observe something like, more intense playing of his music, the revival of his music? How can you describe it? What tendency is in general in Greece, for example?
We continue to work on his music, of course, and there are a lot of concerts organized this last year. It is 1 year. He dead was one year ago, and it was a festival destined to his music and to his work, organized on September in Zatuna in Arcadia, and also in Crete in his honor. And there are a lot of concerts who are organized also in the opera in Athens, presenting his work.
A small comment to that, Kalliopi. Okay, I don't live in Greece, but my subjective impression is that Theodorakis was always popular, and just 1 year, and he's still very popular. It does, yeah. So it was always popular, I think, and was always played. Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, and stayed, and don't, yeah, yeah. That's my personal, my subjective impression.
I think it's not subjective, it's objective. It's like that, of course.
Well, I think we can thank Kalliopi once again and grab some coffee.
So welcome back, everyone, to our last part of the session. And please welcome our dear colleague, Dina Lentsner from Capital University in Columbus, Ohio, USA. And she will present a paper called Erich Eschenwald's as a Post-Feminist Communicating Body in Legend of the Walled-in Woman. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Andrius. I'm going to be standing, if you don't mind, because I like to use my arms and hands and move. And not very convenient for online transmission, but is it okay? Okay. Thank you so much. Of course, this topic is very different from my Kurtág studies, completely different. I find musical communication study to be one of the most confusing, contradictory, vague, and inconclusive areas of music scholarship. In one of the essays comprising the book titled Musical Communication from 2005, Hargreaves et al. Point out that to investigate the subject, one needs to consider all the details of the how, why, who, and where. And it looks like no one has done it comprehensively just yet. To frame my exploration of the communicative properties of a piece of music under my investigation, I employ what Hargreaves et al. Call a reciprocal feedback model of musical communication that comprises two counterparts. The first factor focused on a musical response. is based on the truism that, quote, the representations of music by the composer and the listener, the former's expressive intentions and the listener's affective response may be quite different from one another, unquote. The model recognizes that consideration of the listener's preparedness to connect to the music they hear and specific of their social, emotional, and logistical situation all play their role in the listener's experience with music. The second counterpart of Hargreaves et al. Model focuses on the role of musical performance, signifying that music becomes an audible phenomenon via complex web of multi-level interactions, resulting in specific interpretation of the score by the performers. The authors argue that only by combining the consideration of all the variables going into music as a performance and those defined by an individual listener's response, that we can come closer to understanding the process by which the spark between music and the listener occurs, thus stimulating the listener's active engagement with a piece of music. This theoretical framework is helpful, since in this paper, I argue that as both a listener and an interpreter of the music I discussed today, I'm one to define its communicative properties. You may not hear what I hear. You may not see what I see, and you definitely may not think what I think. But in my view, this is exactly a phenomenological nature of music as human experience that makes it a timeless and borders-defying phenomenon. Legend of the World in Woman by Latvian composer Erik Sošinots was written in 2005. It is based on Albanian legend of Rozata Castle in Northern Albania, but the legend itself is just one of the multitude of existing versions spread all over the Balkan region. Common to all renditions is the basic plot involving a group of young men building either a castle or a bridge or a monastery, and through some kind of supernatural intervention, whatever is constructed is destroyed at night. In the Albanian version of the legend used by Eschenwald, the mother of three brothers, masons, builders of the castle, had a prophetic dream, according to which, in order to break the negative magic spell, one of her daughters-in-law, whichever one brings lunch to the construction site next day, should be sacrificed. Two older brothers warn their wives about their mother's dream, but the youngest, the naive one, did not. The next day, his young wife, Rosaka, who just had a baby, brought them food. And then she was told that she was to be immured inside the foundation of the castle. But this is not all. Apparently, Rozava, I'm quoting this website where I found these pictures. Rozava accepted her fate, but under one condition. The brothers would leave a hole for her right breast so her newborn son could feed, another hole for her right hand to caress him, and a third hole for her right foot to move his cradle. The castle never collapsed, end of quote. Eschenwald's, in his composition, he incorporates the authentic Albanian folk song, believed to be dating from the time that Rozava Castle was built around 2,700 years ago. And he incorporated it in the fabric of his composition. I'm going to play an excerpt from this folk song by this folk ensemble, Albanian folk ensemble. We'll try again because it was double. Thank you.
forward.
The text of the folk song that you just saw in previous screen excluded the last significant part of the story, having to do with the young woman's response to the demand of your sacrifice. To fill that textual void, Eschenwald decided to use the English translation of Vendit Tem, My Land, a poem by 20th century Albanian poet Martin Kamaj that complemented the folk song with a slight variation of the young woman's conditioned self-sacrifice. When I die, may I turn into grass on my mountains in spring. In autumn, I will turn in seed. When I die, may I turn into water. My misty breath will fall onto the meadows as rain. When I die, may I turn into stone on the confines of my land. May I be a landmark. In this paper, I argue that the legend by itself, as well as Eschenwald's setting, present a curious interaction of the two major contemporary ideologies, the feminist and post-feminist, intricately intertwined with one another. The feminist perspective is well warranted. However barbaric the legend seems to be, its core has had a long and dark history of patriarchal oppression of women and reduction of their place in culture and society to their biological state and function. On this and the following slide, I included just a few quotes from the abundant body study scholarship. Writing in 1999, Gates sums it up, quote, "Recent feminist research suggests that the history of Western thought shows a deep hatred and fear of the body." Spillman, 1999, elaborates, quote, "What philosophers had to say about women typically has been nasty, brutish, and short." A page or two of quotations from those considered among the great philosophers, Aristotle, Hume, and Nietzsche, for example, constitutes a veritable litany of contempt, unquote. So it's not all at all surprising that the role in woman in the legend is a mother who, by having a son, has already fulfilled her biological function. But curiously, the woman who saw the dream with the instruction of a sacrifice is also a mother. Miike Ball, 1986, writes, quote, "It's common insight that the female body scares men by its otherness, its lack, and its obscurity," unquote. So it's plausible that a victim's mother-in-law was assigned the role of a villain or a witch, also as a strategy of oppression and sexism. Furthermore, the area of scholarship categorized as sacrificial studies offers diverse and often conflicting frameworks for understanding of the undercurrent of the sacrifice taking place in the legend of Rozafa, including René Girard, 1977 view of the sacrifices as a redirected aggression of the society, and Peter Leeson's 2014 theory of rational human sacrifice, which considers it as, quote, "a technology for protecting property rights," unquote. Through Girard's framework, one can conceptualize the sacrifice of Rozafa as her community's expression of fear and despair. Leeson's theory, however, suggests communities' manipulative and well-calculated political economical moves, victimizing one of the marginalized members of their community. And thus the semantics of the dark, sorrowful, haunting, as it restrained Albanian polyphonic folk song that Eschenwald absorbed into his work, is open to many interpretations. Which leads me to the discussion of the importance of a specific performance in my connection to an internalization and analysis of this Eschenwald's composition. There are two excellent recordings of Legend of the World in Woman available commercially. One by Latvian Radio Choir and another one by Portland State Chamber Choir. These two performances differ majorly in the interpretation of the score. The Latvian version is striking and captivating in its focus on the lamenting element. The stasis of the structural framework complemented by highlighting of the interworkings of the inner voices. This approach to music semantics emphasizes a disturbing, as if suffocating, containment of an emotion or a body or a soul. The American version is quite different, for it highlights the transformational feature of music in terms of its texture, harmonic density, melodiousness, and stylistic juxtapositions. These differences between the two recordings are really striking, deeply affecting my own understanding of this Eschenwald's work, which leads me back to the reciprocal model of musical performance by Hargreaves et al. That I mentioned above. For it recognizes the critical role of professional musicians, intellectual, emotional, physical, and contextual engagement with the score before the score becomes music to be heard. For this presentation, I chose the latter, Portland State Chamber Choir performance, for no other reason that it just was first one I heard. And I'm going to play four very short examples. The first two are from the opening of the work, the third example from the middle, and the last one near the end of the work. Okay. So this is in the beginning. The last example. On this slide, I represented this work structure as an ascension to recognize the dynamics of transformation that this particular performance emphasized. The composer structures the work as an intensifying continuum of the overlapping, stylistically conflicting sections, including an authentic folk lament that indicated on yellow, if you can see the colors. Just a second. Allusions to the sacred music from plain chant to chorale in the first two segments that you heard, to the soaring expressive melodies in green color, incorporating the lament and evolving harmonic intensity, and you heard it in the third example, and eventually to the quieter introspective lyricism of the final section with a lament on the background. And I kind of emphasize it in like fuchsia color. An allusion to the plain chant I hear in the opening tenor solo is specific to this particular performance. And the score is just paired with a lament featuring grace notes and small span downward motif as if sign downward motif. And then Eschenwald masterfully creates a structural overlap with the almost translucent sounding chorale-like episodes by means of evaded cadence. So I kind of tried to represent this overlap by placing consequent sections kind of on top of each other, which of course can have semantic repercussions. I find it significant that Eschenwald creates the first section sectional overlap through an enharmonically respelled common tone, B flat versus A sharp. So this B flat, flat versus A sharp, lament and polyphonic density versus harmonic quietness, weightlessness and transparency. I suggest semantically these recurring alternate episodes invite the consideration of woman's body versus woman's soul dichotomy, and eventually her body versus her voice dichotomy, when the chorale breaks through the border of A sharp and transforms into what I call the soaring, emotionally charged melodic counterpoint that we heard in the third example that I played. Let's briefly entertain the question of semantics. What does Eschenwald communicate in terms of his portrayal of this ancient Albanian legend? Is it a grief for a woman, a human being treated as a construction material, or a grief for a community guided by fear and superstition that is expressed in the persistent throughout the piece lament that is always almost there in some form. And because of the overlapping section, the effect is that even if it stops, that we still hear it, so as if it never stopped and never will. Does the composer give his bold in heroine a voice in those soaring melodic lines to express her resistance and her creative power and to transcend her essence beyond the constraint of the walls of the oppressive society? Perhaps the answers to all these questions are yes, but only until we consider what I call the problem of the last section, which is the last example that we've heard. For some listeners, the last excerpt is the most beautiful one in the work. For me, however, it represents a semantic dissonance. Just like in the legend in the poem by Martin Kamai, which Eschenwald says in that section, young woman succumbs to her fate, conceptualizing her self-sacrifice as a transfiguration, transition to becoming one with the nature, with her land. Eschenwald, in a sense, celebrates her choice through overflowing lyricism of that section of soprano solo, followed by the soprano duet, as if the young woman's choice to be victimized for the sake of your community encourages others to be free to make their own choices about their physical existence. And this sentiment, I suggest, reflects the post-feminist narrative broadly represented in the current scholarship, well summarized by Gill 2017, who points out to the following position of this ideology. Quote, the notion of femininity as bodily property, the shift from objectification to subjectification, an emphasis upon self-surveillance, monitoring, self-discipline, a focus on individualism, choice, and empowerment, and the resurgence of ideas about natural sexual differences, unquote. My complicated relationship with this work, this work's ending especially, led me to the following realization. It is my relationship with feminism and post-feminism that are conflicting and complicated. And it is, quoting Hargreaves et al, music's self-reflective aboutness that engendered my own self-reflection and illuminated my musical and analytical sensibilities in regards to this work. The music and its listener always create that unique communicative space located somewhere between the composer's artistic intentions, the music performative embodiment, and one's own perceptive and interpretive mechanism, always informed by their personal and cultural biases. And today in front of you, I stand by mine. Thank you.
Thank you, Dina. Any questions, comments?
Thank you so much for a very nice presentation. And I have a question about this ending, of course. But the main idea which I have, why only on the ending he used sopran? Why only on the ending? During all piece, I understand that he don't use solo sopran. Maybe it's this is the key for understanding this ending, but
well, to me it is the key. To me,
but
well, Eric wanted to just have a beautiful melody sometimes. That was he just wanted to have beautiful melody sometimes.
This is kind of teleological endings, and
Yes, and by the way, so it was interesting to hear. You know, in the United States, choristers are trained as vocalists, as opera or musical theater performers. So they have more vibrato, and of course, in the Baltic countries, they are the straight tone and which I actually prefer. Yeah. Well, I know in Latvia, Eric told me, in Latvia, choristers not allowed to.
One more question. How about lower voices? Is there in this piece some fragments with lower voices?
No, because it's about woman, and of course, the woman's supposed to have soprano.
I mean,
yes, low voices are there. They're
also,
part, so this piece is there is a choir and ensemble of soloists. In the choir, okay. And the voices speak a lot of piano because of the wall concept of the wall. And yes.
I also would like to share some observations as someone who actually earns a living from singing at the choir. I've done quite a few pieces of Eric Eschewald's myself, and yes, he always tries to write some really beautiful music, but I don't know this piece. I have it's the first time I see it, but from those score examples, I get this teleological sense that he, At the beginning, he presents this very substantial divisi of male voices and only altos. He presents kind of a male perspective on it. And the female voices are the low, like bodily voices. And he gradually shifts towards more, adding more high frequencies, higher female voices. Yes, and he ends on a soprano duo. It's like presenting the perspective of a woman.
And also, as I mentioned before, breaking out of the wall metaphorically, and with this wall I call soaring melody, you know, so that the bird in the sky, so it breaks, even if your body is, in the wall, she walked in, but her soul transcends all the boundaries. Perhaps that was an idea.
Thank you, Dina. Just two short questions. The first one regarding the plain chant, was it Eschenwald's original or did he use some quotation? And another one, it's about connection to this Albanian folk song. You mentioned that Eschenwald's, he used the text, but what about the melody intonation?
The first excerpt I played was a folk song.
Ah, so the plain chant is...
When I showed the text of the...
Yes.
So that was actually original.
Yes, I understand. And how it is used in the Eschenwald's work, is it some kind of logic or also like expanding?
He basically quotes that.
Only quotes.
He quotes that and it's always there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he harmonized it a little bit because they have slides, they have not microtonal, but you know, they're folk singers. Mm-hmm. So, So he incorporates it almost like authentic.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
He takes pride in using the same material
out.
Same question. He takes pride in that he uses, because since I worked on many of his compositions for his at his request, we were just talking with Andrew about that. Because I always say, like, well, are you, especially with minority groups, I said, are you, in a sense, recolonizing them? And he said, well, I quote them verbatim. So he takes pride in them.
Yes. I know that you have a collaboration with him, with composer, and did we interview him about this music during the analysis? I'm interested, this content of legend, is it included in music?
Content of legend. Oh, content of legend.
Legend. Included in music or only the shape, idea? And text.
Well, he is a composer who is very serious about the literary sources he uses. This piece, it was not, this piece is not part of my collaboration with him. This piece was accidental discovery on my part when I was working on a, project, the embodiment of a woman project with my collaborator from literary studies. And I accidentally heard this piece. So I didn't really care about what Eric had to say about it. I'm a phenomenologist, I kind of don't care what composer thing, but I asked him specific questions in Albanian legend, and he's very kind. He sent me links to the internet. He finds a lot of information on the internet. So he found that legend on the internet. And he connects to the text, to the legend, and expresses it in the way composers do. Like, how do you express it? The way it just comes out, right? So I don't know if he wanted to express anything, or he thought about anything that I interpreted in his work. And I invited him to this conference. I said, would you like to hear about your music, what you have in your music? He said, I don't know if
if I'm ready to hear that about him being feminist and post-feminist. So, I don't really know, how. And he writes fast, and when he's inspired, and for commissions because of the deadlines. So, I think it's one of his good pieces, and it's one of the popular ones. That even though you haven't sung it yet, but I think it's effective piece, except for the last section that I have problem with.
Thank you very much. I think we have to move on to another presentation. And our next presentation is an online one. It's Svitlana Postovoitova from National Music Academy of Ukraine. Welcome, Svitlana, and her presentation is called Large Polyphonic Cycles of Ukrainian Composers of the 20th and the Early 21st Centuries, the Problem of Musical Communication.
Thank you. Good afternoon, dear participants of the conference. I'm glad that I can join the conference, and I'm very grateful for the invitation and the opportunity to present my topic. My speech will be from a video recording because I'm worried about whether the internet and light will be stable. Then please enjoy my topic. Thank you. Large polyphonic cycles of Ukrainian composers of the 20th and the 21st century, the problem of music communication. Historically, the genre of the large polyphonic cycle was formed in creativity of Johann Sebastian Bach and had the aim to introduce in the art practice all the tones of the tempered line and to show the polyphonic mastery. In the 20th and the 21st century, both these trends have been preserved, but the goal of creation has changed. Each cycle becomes an individual composer's project, whose originality and uniqueness is revolved only on condition of complete fascination. It should be noted that the modern large polyphonic cycle is mostly large in scope, with various and numerous internal connects, written with modern composer's techniques. Therefore, his understanding, performance, and perception pose significant communication problems. In our opinion, the way of overcome them lies first of all through the research of the composition and dramatic components of the cycle, which determine the significance of the composer's idea in general, give an opportunity to complete the idea of a large artistic canvas. Such work was carried out in relation to three significant for the Ukrainian music of the second half of the 20th, early 21st century, the large polyphonic cycles of Alexander Karamanov, Valentin Vidix, and Borislav Stromkos. We also summarize the result of this work in the following summary. In the cycle 15 concert fugues of Alexander Karamanov, there was a significant transformation of the polyphonic cycle due to the inclusion of fugues in the context of avant-garde writing techniques. Also planned, the edition of the cycle in 1984 and its initial plan differ significantly. For instance, four more fugues had to be added to it, including two H-voice and adult fugues, 12 voice dismal fugues, 2 triple fugues, and 5 preludes, which together with the 15 fugues form the transformed version 19 plus 5 for the Bach construction 24. Dramaturgy. Due to the lack of parts left in manuscripts, it will be difficult to keep an eye on the full dramaturgic images of the 15 concert fugues because of the absence of fugues and preludes, the large scale, difficult, and hypothetically could form cumulizing zones. But in in the its youth, teaching concepts, the Ursus principle of the building the circle as a whole is clearly seen. The composer builds a circle based on the desire to awaken the audience, show the maximum possibilities of the fugue, which shifts the emphasis on the concert or the piano style. An important factor which allows to concentrate completely only on the polyphonic progress is the factor of the absence of prelude, the decomposition of the traditional small cycle, prelude, fugue. For some fugue, taking into account the number of voices, peculiarities of polyphonic scene and voices, it is necessary to use even two pianos. Also, in the cycle, there are two fugues reaching for the piano and organ. Constructive idea. According to the author's instruction, the fugues are located on the ascending chromatic range. Absence of pacings, offset of mood, use of all 12 tones, often serially organized. Here's an opportunity to speak about the using of individual functional tonal organization in each of them. Listen to the fugue number 3. Cycles such as for preludes and fugues, Valentin Biritz, the main concept is a philosophical concept, which is reflected by the Ursus program names of the part, reflection, intensity, and alignment. Ursus idea. In the first part, the images of contemplation, philosophical, self-deepening revival in the second part, and more effective energetic images, dramatic concentration. The third part can be considered as a certain transformation of the first images, which are presented in lighter and softer tones. Dramaturgy. Three notebooks are three different stages of dramaturgy, each of which has its own logic and development and its own commentizing zones. Very important factor in the realization of the concept of reflection, intensity, and enlightenment is a functional intonation connection between preludes and fugues, which correlate with each other with two modules, dependent on the degree is interaction between the intonation and semantic material of the parts. In the first notebook reflection, fugue is a strong content element, which in its dramatic importance and scale prevails over the leptic preludes. In the second notebook, intensity, the functional correlation of moods and fugues transpires with the other module. Fugues stops to be the center. The emphasis moves into the prelude or in area of its ending or its beginning. The scale of improvisation of perfection reduced, and now it reflects the process of forming an idea, the subject of fugue. If Asa appears at the end of the prelude, all is internally grasped from the prelude's scene. The slide shows the main semantic elements of prelude, A, B, C, and the subject of the fugue, which consists all these magic elements. Constructive ideal. Lyric offers an original version of the original based on the tonal principle. This diagram defines the number of parts. 14 plus 10 plus 10 will be 34. The tonal concept is only biological design, and the smooth organization of each individual preludes and fugues goes far beyond the presentation of the certain tonality and has its own individual system. So, listen, Biedig's prelude and fugues number 5 from the first notebook reflection. Modern preludes and fugues in Zeig, Borys, and Gost shows another Ost version of the cycle interpretation, which caused by the non-traditional combination of modality and polyphonic principles. Ost's idea. As the composer noted, the goal is to put into task his polyphonic mastery in new sound science condition using the modality of writing. The cycle of preludes and fugues are located on the chronology of creation, from the first to the 11th. The cycle is potentially open, and as the composer himself commanded, he did not seek to reproduce the traditional logic of 24 tonality or a sailed system of structure, but sought to achieve freedom and emphasize the inaccuracies of the process. Dramaturgy of the cycle. The basis of the dramaturgy in the author's idea of the max stay in different sound spaces to the cycle is essentially based on their demonstration of the principle of correlation. Constructive idea. The composer deliberately limited each prelude and fugue to sound scale of a specific structures, which gave an opportunity to create composition with a bright individual color. For all compositions of the cycle, the tone C is indicated as a reference present at the beginning and end of the presented scenes. Also, it may not be final tone. Each prelude and fugues has an individual specific structures, which is reflected in the presentation table. Because of the actual absence of traditional modulation, the moment of the narrative development of the scene is taken off and replaced by internal process of the transformation of the scene. The effect of constant states in the single sound system is created. The state effect in one place increases. So, listen to Stringov Prelude number 7. The analysis of the three cycles of Ukrainian composers allowed to accent their fundamental characteristics, which confirmed that so tells that the large polyphonic cycle of the 20th-21st century is probably the most complicated organization among the other possibilities tubes of cycles. Modern cycles are based on the author's idea, which they realized at the level of implementation of the general constructive idea, composition and dramatic development. At the point of view of construction, a large polyphonic cycle is multi-level system, the central element of which is fugue. Fugue is a complex organization structure itself. The cycle activates interaction at the level of fugues with fugues, per cycle of with fugues, fugues with interlude, and small cycles among each other. In the considered works, each composer created an individual model of a large polyphonic cycle. Harmonic opened new possibilities of fugue and polyphony by means of high level of performance difficulty, leaving part of the cycle as a developed philosophical concept, which has own phases of the development. Stringov stressed in the infinity of long staying in different, unusual for polyphony, sound atmospheres, and in fact revealed the openness of the form of a large polyphonic cycle. The analysis of these works proved is it based on the understanding of integrity as an artistic phenomenon? Each polyphonic cycle cannot be seen only as sum of parts. Therefore, semantic performance of fugues, preludes and fugues, which is often found in the modern performance practice, is possible, but in self-sufficient, as it separates these fragments from the general artistic context. The familiarization of the author's concept requires the performance of the cycle by one whole concept, which is an extremely difficult task, both in terms of its physical realization and in terms of its audience perception of intellectuality, satiated musical composition of such area. Nowadays, no one of this cycle with Ukrainian has been fully implemented from the beginning to the end. The exception is only for Vedic cycle, in which has performed by the American pianist Timothy Gore, with three concerts in Las Vegas in 2019. Its total duration is 3 hours. Thus, we could say the solution of the problem of communication in carrying out large polyphonic cycles of the 21st centuries has at last two important aspects. The first is the work of the performer on such a large-scale work should be done with own research. The performer has to realize the complexity of the cycle structure, hidden internal links, and through analytical work to develop the performance strategy that will bring the whole composer's idea to the audience. The second aspect is a problem of concert realization, because the area of the idea and duration of performance require special conditions and opportunities. Reliance on the peculiarities of the author's concept, such as three parts of Vedic cycle, taken in account by Timothy Gore, and the using of modern media technologies, can at a presentable level provide high-quality communication of a large polyphonic cycle in modern musical West. Thank you for attention.
Thank you, Svetlana. And do we have any questions or comments? And we will follow the same procedure as we did with our previous Ukrainian presenter. The questions will be translated by Irina to Ukrainian.
Thank you, Svetlana, very much. First is a comment, if you don't mind. Are you familiar with the research about Bach's use of a temperate system? To my knowledge, it's there's no evidence that he wrote it for equal temperament, because they used different temperaments at that time. So I think there is, at least for the past maybe 30 years, right, there is a research that kind of negates that assumption that he wrote for well-temperate. Well-temperate doesn't mean equal temperament. So it's just a comment. My question, however, is with the Karamanov's fugues, especially his 8-part fugues. So we know that Bach had trouble with 6-part fugue in the musical offering. So like what in terms of communication or artistic concept, why did Karamanov felt the need to write such a complex, Bach couldn't do it, and I'm going to do it, 8-part. And I think it was two fugues in 8 parts, according, right? Yes. Yeah. So what was the concept, kind of, if composer ever specified the concept of complexity, why such complexity? Maybe the first question, and then I can maybe ask another one.
Добрий день. Зрозуміли чи ні?
Світ, все. Значить, перше була перше був коментар, що вони писали, що то Бах писав 24 Господи, свої прелюдії та фуги для рівномірно темперованого строю, але це не доведено і взагалі почав використовуватися реально в практиці цей стрій на 30 років тому, і тому тут треба якби більш обережно ставитися до саме цієї термінології. Це був коментар. І перше запитання стосується восьмиголосної фуги Караманова, тому що це дуже складно. Бах мав проблеми з шестиголосною фугою. Тому яка сута ідея, яка концепція була того, що Караманов використав настільки складну саме восьмиголосну фугу?
Дякую за запитання. Проблема в тому, що ці восьмиголосна і дванадцятиголосні фуги залишились лише в рукописах, які, на жаль, ми не змогли дістати, тому що вони знаходяться в іншій країні зараз. Тому, звичайно, про концепцію не можу сказати, але враховуючи той досвід, що в циклі є шестиголосні фуги, які написані для двох інструментів, я міркую, що його завдання було створити твір саме для двох інструментів. Як це технологічно виконується, на жаль, не можу сказати, саме через відсутність автографу.
These fugues for 8 and 12 voices now only in the archive of Karamana. That fugue is not published, and as I understood, this archive now in Russia, and we have the possibility to see these fugues, and it was only information. But Svetlana has experienced to work with fugues of six voices, шестиголосну фугу, да, Свет? For six voices, and this fugue was created for two instruments. And proposition that fugues for 8 and 12 voices were created for two instruments, but now it's only proposition.
Second question? Unless somebody else.
Hello, thank you for the presentation. I just would add what Dina commented about this eight-part fugue, that I suppose I read somewhere that maximum six-part fugue is possible for human to accept and to hear different six lines. That's why eight, it's already over maximum. Yeah, extra. And my second comment would be about also connecting why this maybe eight-part fugue. I think this from the 70s Karamanov cycle reflects that general tendency that was in all our Soviet countries, typical for composers in the 70s, experimenting with the avant-garde techniques, with the dodecaphonic series. While I listening to Bibik's in music, I also think that it reminds what was typical in 80s, like this coming back to somehow to neo-romanticism or a little bit moderate thinking. And this in 2003 strong composition. In Lithuania, for example, we may think about all this minimalistic approach and repetitiveness much earlier than in 2003. So, but I see very a lot of resemblance in all this approach, communicating like making a message from that period, and maybe approach from this point also.
Значить, перший був коментар до того, що, як показує практика, що для такого людського сприйняття вже добре 6 голосів, тобто більше ніж 6 голосів людина сприйняти не може, і тому тут дійсно можуть бути запитання щодо цього, навіщо Караманов це робив. А далі йде This is more commentar than question. Єрима. Це більше коментар, ніж запитання, тому що от цикли, що ви показували, вони були створені в різні часи. І коли ми слухаємо цикл Караманова, це експерименти, авангардові експерименти 70-х років. Коли цикл Бібіка, то більше рефлексія і якби аналогії з тими от неоромантичними тенденціями. І коли ми маємо на початок 2000-х, коли було створено цикл Стренька, це більш такий от мінімалізм. І от ці от характерні риси кожного от цього періоду от показуються в цих циклах, і можливо, якби такі референси, віднесення їх до, можливо, якось в таких от комунікативних стратегіях розглядати по відношенню до тих типових рис, що були в той чи інший період. Транслейт.
Так, я погоджуюсь, в принципі, з цим коментарем, розуміючи те, що дійсно всі цикли Караманова були створені в таких авангардних техніках. Це дійсно був експеримент, він сам це зазначав, і ми чуємо це з музики. Що стосується Бібіка, то ми прослухали одну з найбільш показових для першого зофіту, який називається «Роздуми», прелюдія та фуги, але інші, вони також мають певний експериментальний пошуковий напрямок, тому що, на мою думку, його головним завданням було почути певне звучання теми і її можливості суміщення в різних якостях, в різних голосах, в різних регістрах і типах виконання. Що стосується Стринька, це дійсно правильний влучний коментар, тому що основна лінія композитора – це написання творів в мінімалістичній техніці. І прелюдії і фуги вийшли дуже цікавими з цієї точки зору, адже використовувати мінімалістичну техніку у фугах це змінило повністю традиційне розуміння і традиційне розгортання і розвиток тематизму.
Thank you, Rima. Svetlana, agree with you for all. Have some commentaries, for example, about Bibik, because she shows one only fuga, and it is very characteristic. Characteristic fuga for this Bibik, but in other fugas he did some interesting experiments with a theme, and he was interested that theme and its sounding in different voices, in different modification, in different registers, and so on, so on. And Svetlana thinks that this experimental ideas are very important for Bibik in his cycle. And what about Stranko? She agrees with you, and he works in such minimalistic manner, at that it's minimalistic manner is short for him and for this cycle of preludes and fugues. Okay.
Yeah. would like to add a little comment. Well, I'm not really an expert on Baroque music, but when I look at the Bach's well-tempered clavier, I don't really see it as a single piece of music. I see it more as a fundamental research of writing for in this genre of connecting the concept of tonalities. And even Bach is really classical composer, and it's really popular, but it's very rarely you hear a performance of the whole thing or two volumes at the single concert. And I think if contemporary composer expects to have a performance of like 34 fugues, I think he has to like rethink his thinking.
It's commentary, yeah, Andrius. Це був тільки коментар, тому що Андрій каже, я не є спеціалістом у музиці барокко, але я не думаю, що Бах думав про те, що всі 48 прелюдій та фуг з двох циклів будуть виконуватися в один вечір. Це, скоріше, для нього також був певний там пошук якихось елементів. І, можливо, також, що композитори, про яких ви говорили, ніхто не думав, що всі ці 34 фуги будуть гратися в один вечір. Тобто, можливо, цієї ідеї і не було. І це, скоріше, не запитання, як якраз просто як коментар на те, щоб от подумати на перспективу.
Я можу відповісти також на коментар, чому? Тому що, наприклад, з Бориславом Спринком ми спілкувалися особисто, і він зауважує те, що дуже було б важливо для того, щоб презентувати його цілісну концепцію, щоб ці твори прозвучали одним концертом. З приводу Бібіка також ми проговорювали з Бенкою, композитора, ідеї про те, що дійсно хотілося б представити цю авторську концепцію на декількох концертах, що презентує всі три частини, повністю весь цикл, тому що там є зверх ідея, яку б хотів передати композитор. А також я знаю з бесіди з Теоретикінію, яка брала інтерв'ю у Караманова ще при його житті, що він також казав про шалену ідею виконати весь його цикл єдиним концертом, тому що ця енергетика має пронизати слухача, і він має зреагувати на це не як окрему одну частину, а як цілісний, драматургічно цілісний твір великий.
In general, all composers want that whole cycle will be performed in one evening, for example. Strenko, Svetlana had interview with Strenko, and he said about that. She knows interview with Karamanov, and he wanted it because his cycle had such energetic over idea, big energetic idea, and this concept probably may be understandable only then they play in a whole cycle. And the same this Bibik, because his cycle have three parts, and the idea of daughter Bibik's daughter, that three evenings and this all three parts. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And so our very last presenter of this conference is Irina Tukova, also from the National Music Academy of Ukraine. And her presentation, which I believe will connect our little research bubble with the current reality, called Communicating War, Multimedia Performance Lullaby for Mariupol by Ilya Razumenko, Roman Grigoriev, and Ensemble Opera Aperta.
The full-scale invasion of Russia has drastically affected all levels of art scene in Ukraine, including its music life. After a period of shock and confusion, Ukrainian musicians have redirected their activity, focusing on two goals: to support Ukrainian army forces in any way possible, and to reinforce cultural diplomacy, including the worldwide popularization of Ukrainian music and conveying the truth about the work using musical art. Most of the new works by Ukrainian composers may be grouped into two categories. The first one represents reflections on experiencing of war. The second category includes manifestations of an idea or concept. The first larger group includes Lacrimosa Bucha by Victoria Poleva, The Fishes Reply to Saint Anthony by Alexei Shmurak, Footprints on the Sun by Maxim Kolomeitz, among other compositions, in which authors try to illustrate personal and social experience of the wartime using familiar metaphors and symbols. Some of those works embody the themes of war explicitly, including its troubling soundscapes, such as the sounds of the air raid sirens in Lacrimosa by Alexander Shchetinsky and Eyes to Eyes by Evgeny Petrichenko, the sounds of shoots or explosions in Lacrimosa Bucha by Victoria Poleva, and so on. The main idea of such compositions is to capture the whole spectrum of wartime emotions and psychological conditions. The second group includes different artistic performances which took place in different cities all over the world for Ukraine's support. One of the works in this category is multimedia performance Lullaby for Mariupol by composers Ilya Razumeyko, Roman Grigoriev, and Ensemble Opera Aperta, created in early spring of 2022. This work may be studied as typical for contemporary art music composition at the levels of structure and musical means, which makes it possible to compare it with the composition of the first block. In general, in the communication aspect, most of artworks can be studied from different positions, among them one of their target audience, and also according to their concept and means for their realization. In the case of Ukraine art music at the time of the war, composers very accurately identify their potential listeners in different levels. The first level can be defined as the geographical one. A composition oriented to an exclusively Ukraine audience, to a foreign audience, or having no such limitation. The second level connects with the sphere of the listener's artistic preferences, where roughly if the communication potential of a composition is directed to a traditional art music audience or to a larger public. All compositions of the first group have no geographical limits and are oriented towards a traditional art music audience. Proof of such statement are the places of their premieres. In many cases, there were philharmonic concerts in Ukraine, works by Shchetinsky, Petrichenko, Poleva, or special projects of European art music ensembles. One of them was organized by Latin's Ensemble with premiere of performance composition by Shmurak and Kolomeitz. The performance Lullaby for Mariupol is presented in different European countries only and oriented towards a larger public. The premieres were in Vienna and Rotterdam in May. In September, the performance was presented in Linz and in October in Milan. Such difference between the communicative direction of the first and second groups of the composition is conditioned by their main concept. The reflections may be interpreted in different ways by listeners, by those who are located inside the country of the war and by those outside. A manifestation may be aimed only at audience in foreign countries. In such a way, I can explain the communicative differences between newly created works by Ukrainian composers connected to the difference in the venues of their premiere performances and specifically between members of an audience. Further, I am concentrating on the creative of Grigoriev-Razumeyko tandem and on the multimedia performance Lullaby for Mariupol only, and trying to analyze the main concept of the performance and the means of its achievement. The creativity of Grigoriev and Razumeyko tandem is provocative and not typical for Ukrainian music arts scene in general.
Those composers have been working together for a long time, and the main result of their activity are operas and music theater composition. This is Grigoriev and Razumenko, their portraits. And among their operas is Opera Requiem Eve, Opera Circus Babylon, Opera Ballet the Ark, Archaeological Opera Chernobyl Door, Opera Lingua, and so on. You can see the list of this work. They also were awarded honorable Ukraine and international prizes for the Opera Requiem Eve and the Archaeological Opera Chernobyl. I will not put in this paper the question why were all compositions named operas, but I am trying to generalize the main features of the operas and their communicative directions, because it is the same approach Grigoriev and Razumenko used in Lullaby for Mariupol. In order to give an insight about Osa's type of work, I suggest watching the official teaser of Opera Lingua. It was created 2021. Razumenko very accurately understand their listeners' capabilities and expectations. From my observation, their audience consists of young and middle ages generation of intellectuals who is interested in contemporary philosophy, literature, theater, jazz, rock music, etc. Although this audience does not have much experience in contemporary art music, but seeks such experience, new both emotional and intellectual impressions. Their communication strategy is formed based on such accurate understanding of listeners. Grigoriev and Razumenko work in the sphere of popular art music, if I could name it in such a way, and try to be understandable for their audience. Therefore, to achieve this goal, their composers choose. Understandable concept of an opera and decision of its plot in postmodern way. They may use biblical subjects, well-known literary plots, popular modern ideas of Borys, Heisinger, Hesse, etc. Using multimedia and scenography, which is shocking for the Ukrainian audience. Combination of contemporary art music and popular music idioms. Using quotations from well-known compositions, using folk material, applying aleatoric and extended performance techniques, using different noises, their combination, the tones, very loud and quiet dynamics, etc. In every composition by Grigoriev and Razumenko, we can find different combinations of such means. For me, it was very interesting to study the reactions of opera spectators, which show the effectiveness of the composer's communicative strategy. I haven't done special research, but I had various discussions, read reviews, etc. In general, every opera had great success with listeners. The typical reaction is, I rethought music, sound, theater, world, and myself. This like quotation from of my one of person with him I had discussion. Only a small group of professional musicians in the field of contemporary art discussed the unoriginality of the masses both of music and stage using well-known means, construction, and so on. From my own experience at the premiere of Opera Lingua, my colleague and I have been amused ourselves for seeing the next musical and stage decision.
But if it would be considered seriously, it wouldn't be interesting. In Lullaby for Mariupol, Grigoriev and Buzumeika used the same means as in their other operas. And in the context of political manifestation, those tools worked perfectly. The performance was created for European listeners or widely for all who live outside Ukraine since 24 of February 2022. The concept of the composition is to remind about the tragedy of Mariupol, which took place in spring at the time of the performance's composition and premiere. As Roman Grigoriev said, quotation, the Lullaby for Mariupol's function is not only about art. Mariupol has a cultural and diplomatic mission at least, and at most it proves that we exist, quotation marks. Now, I am not describing the tragedy of Mariupol, its civilians and defenders. I hope everybody knows about it. So, from the above mentioned indicative features of Grigoriev and Tuzumeika creativity in Lullaby for Mariupol are used, multimedia. In the performance are applied video series by Dmitry Tintyuk. The video set consists in different pictures from destroyed Mariupol. In its climatic point, video from Dawn is used, which shows the reality of the bombed and shot city. The basis of the performance is improvisation, therefore the aleatoric technique is used. In the performance are combined macrotonal instrumental improvisation on flute, duduk, and Ukraine national instruments such as bandura and cymbali, this vocal improvisation in folk manner. Extended performance techniques are actively applied, for example, playing the bandura like the cymbale, i.e. changing the position of the bandura to horizontal and using sticks. Very loud sounds and noises are applied for the achievement of necessary effects. Folk material is used in the form of Ukraine lullabies. I would like to comment the last position. The usage of lullabies is very popular in different performances and political actions. I know three performances where such folk material was applied. The first naturally is Lullaby for Mariupol. The second one is Lullabies for the Land, which took place in Piazza Castello in Torino on the 1st of May of this year. In the performance, we used lullabies from different Ukrainian regions, which were sung in folk manner. The third example is the performance Lullaby by Daria Kolpsova, the ritual in memorial of all killed Ukrainian children. Such popularity of folk lullaby in the performances may be explained in different ways. For example, from the gender semantic and its incompatibility, this award to lullaby's idioms being understandable for people in different countries and so on. In this context, I'm emphasizing the choice by Grigoriev and Tuzumeika for very simple but effective material for their composition. So, Ilya Razumeika characterized the role of their tandem with Grigoriev in this way. In the beginning, we created a minimalistic instrumental piece and then we expanded it to multimedia performance. Our role as composers in this work is related to the general form structure because it is not a classical Western European composition with a precise score, but a joint meditative funeral ritual that combines traditional vocals, improvisations of our microtonal quartet and video art. In general, a combination of microtonal improvisation heard on loudspeakers, folk singing and the video layers creates a powerful and effective event, encapsulating human life under bombing and shelling. I propose to listen to a short fragment from Lullaby for Mariupol. Unfortunately, the composer and performers didn't have professional resource to record their performance at the premiere. This is a recording from their auditorium. And now, not from. Thank you. Planet communication strategy, it is result. In this case, the reaction of the listeners. I'm quoting some members of the performance in which they are describing the behavior of their audience. Roman Grigoriev, composer. We didn't give any chance to the public to remain indifferent. At the culmination, we showed a video where a drone flies over the destroyed Mariupol, displaying suffering and death. There was only one voice, and we all gradually joined in as a kind of metronome, like a clock. It was the voice of Mariupol, surrounded by explosions. It was illustrative, but very strong. After the performance, we were approached by musicians and festival directors with tears in their eyes. Anna Rudenko, vocalist. We were heard and we managed to reach out, I'm sure. In the eyes of the audience, I saw understanding and compassion, pain and delight, and the eyes do not lie. Marichka Stribulova, vocalist. The performance in Rotterdam was the most impressive in my experience. The whole performance ends with a lullaby that we sing in there's one chord, but just stopped it for half a phrase. Then we finished it for a very long time, like 5 or 7 minutes. There was just silence in the hall, loud, mindful silence. There was no applause. No one moved. It was very strong, but sad, difficult, and touching. This is the only possible reaction to the performance, I think. And as conclusion of my presentation, in the process of work, I put the question for myself. If Lullaby for Mariupol would have been presented in Kyiv, would I attend? And I gave myself the negative answer. Because to a listener inside the war and to one outside it, as I mentioned above, those are two different communicative situations. Thank you for your attention.
Wow, thank you for this very touching presentation. Anybody would like to comment?
Well, the microphone just happened to be close at hand, so I'll grab it. Yeah, that was really very moving. But what is particularly what I want to draw attention to? Now, of course, the whole situation with war and everything is the most pressing issue. But listening to this video clip that you played, I believe this is, outside of any context, very good music. Somehow it grabs you. It has almost a visceral effect. I think it's really a marvelous piece. I would like to have heard it in entirety. I hope it exists somewhere. But I would like to ask the question. I know that someone is in the audience that probably would think in the similar direction about this microtonal. Is it based on real research into the intonation of Ukrainian folk music, which obviously no folk music is 12 tone equal tempered? Or it is just the idea of
thank you. It's not this improvisation. It's only improvisation because these composers, Zmeika and Grigoriev, they like improvisation in general, and they like choosing traditional instruments or orchestral instruments in different way. For example, they play accordion in such a way. They put for example, table and play such a way, accordion and so on. And this only, I think, their ideas, this improvisation, this diapason of sounding and louding of the sound, not some connection this Ukrainian folklore or other music. No, that's only the improvisation, and they recorded this improvisation on audio. They can't fix it in paper or so.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Irina, for presentation. Just short comment that the project by these artists, authors, Chernobyldorf was presented in Lithuania a month ago, you know. Yeah, and thanks for in one slide you showed classifying what it consists all their works, what of they consist, what kind of elements, and this, I would say all this speaks about this type of post-opera kind and this multimedia performance, Lullaby, would we consider it also like post-opera? I think not, or yes. What do you think?
For me, it's just a difficult question because for me, I have the possibility to heard many of their composition, many of their operas, and for me, they have one face, and the same ideas. They have different concepts, but the means of realization is for me the same. And for me, the most probably interesting is Chernobyldorf for this concept, and this Lullaby from Mariupol, because they created a Lullaby as performance and as for input, for special for your European auditorium, because they in May they presented two composition in Rotterdam, Lullaby and Chernobyldorf. And Lullaby is only as manifestation, as political manifestation. And for me, it is the same means, but the decision of this idea, it was for Lullaby very clear idea, very clear message. And as for me, they choose it very strong means for articulation of the idea of this message. As for me, it's now it is very interesting part of different performances, because I saw different performances in such a way. As for me, this is the best of such political manifestation his performances.
May, yes. Ira, I have a kind of two-phase question. You mentioned that you wouldn't, did I understand you correctly, you wouldn't have come to the performance?
No, I saw only recording.
So my first question is, so in terms of a division between in Eastern Europe, which you know I'm familiar with, a division between like highbrow music and lowbrow music, you know, art music and popular music. If these composers sort of like merge, cross over, right, between, kind of, incorporate both. Now, I see it as a very like postmodern move all over world right now, very kind of, we see the same processes. But the reason why you wouldn't come to the performance, is it has to do with what you already mentioned because it's all the same, or it's what semantically embedded in the composition?
The first, I agree with you, their work in the good way compare art music means and popular music means and created is for me interesting product and it's market product and they presented their operas in and USA then EOF I know they presented EOF in USA etc. For me it is very good. Second part of questions is very difficult because we have our community, our society that stay in Ukraine and we are living in Ukraine from beginning, from end of the February. And the specific of ours as professionals and as listeners, very, very different and very specific. If I compare, for example, my experience, this experience, my colleagues who lives abroad the Ukraine, they native Ukraine, but they live abroad the Ukraine. For example, because first of all, and many my colleagues said that first 2 or 3 weeks we can't listen music at all. We can't listen music at all. I remembered my experience. It's only sense without music. And after that, we began to come to our professional. And the same said the composer Grigory Petrozomik in the interview. They said the same things. It's first of all. And the second, not all context that, for example, not only I and my colleagues, that we see in performances into different art actions, for example, we can see. I can't see, for example, some things and I don't want to see in 1 or 2 times, for example, for pictures about destroyed Mariupol and so on. I can't because I know it, but I can't in my psychological level. Because I can't. And the same I asked that's no my conclusion. I asked about them from my colleagues and they're all say it's impossible because we know it and we live in it. And probably somebody in our minds changing for, during this time. And I hope after the victory, we return to normal life.
Thank you.
And so this was the last presentation of this conference. I would like to thank all of you for being here, for presenting online. Without you, this conference would never exist. And I know that the founder of our conference, Professor Rimantas Jendelauskas, would like to say a few words.
I want to say thanks, great thanks, all of you, of particularly our guests, and thanks for all who contributed to this event. Contribution of each speaker and moderator, in my opinion, deserve a great attention and gratitude. I'm sure that our friendship and collaboration will continue in future. So I hope, dear guests, to see you again in Vilnius next year. Good luck. Good luck.
And now we can continue our discussion at the buffet.